Okay, so why the Dionysian primate? We are a primate which does ritual. I'm an evolutionary biologist, and when I look at this kind of social behaviour, and I look at the other species of animals on Earth, this is very, very unusual. We don't see forms of social bonding using ritual, dance and music in any other species. So what I want to look at is possibly the evolutionary reasons why humans do this. Just to start off, I want to look at a quote from Nietzsche's The Birth of Tragedy. And Nietzsche looked at the Dionysian rituals of ancient Greece and kind of suggested that psychedelics were used in them. And this is just a quote. Under the influence of the narcotic potion, hymned by all primitive men and peoples, or in the powerful approach of spring, joyfully penetrating the whole of nature, those Dionysiac urges awakened, and as they grew more intense, subjectivity becomes a complete forgetting of the self. I just want you to keep that idea of forgetting of the self in mind, because it will be very important when I talk more about the default mode network. Communal ritual, it's not observed in any other primate. It's a uniquely human adaptation, and it's usually integrated with religion, music, and dance. It's often involved in psychological and physical healing, and it often evokes altered states of consciousness or trance states. Interestingly, it's usually associated with rites of passage, and particularly significant for what I'm going to talk about, ritual is important for adolescent initiation rites. And here's just a quote from Dewar and Grob on the significance of ritual in the adolescent period of growth. In contrast to dangerous and irreverent use in contemporary society, plant hallucinogens were generally utilised by Homo sapiens within a ritualised, sacrosanct, socially sanctioned context with the intent to contribute to group cohesiveness and survival, particularly in pubertal initiatory rituals of identity. The unique suggestibility properties of the plants made them ideal catalysts for this process. Okay, just a little bit on the archaeological evidence for psychedelic use in Africa. This is the famous Mushroom Man. It's about 7,000 years old. And you can see on this image here, there seems to be a line connecting the mushroom and the head of the people that they're dancing with, suggesting that the mushroom may be altering consciousness. And this is just a poem from Les Murray that encapsulates some of the ideas I'm working with. We come from the Ice Age, we work for the trances, the hunter, the mother, the seer's inside-out glances. To address this issue as to why humans exhibit this quite unusual and enigmatic behaviour, really, one way of approaching it is looking at human growth and development, and particularly growth of the body and growth of the brain. What's worth noting is that humans have an extended period of growth that includes a childhood and adolescent period of brain development. And we also have delayed onset of sexual maturity, which is necessary for socialisation, brain development, as well as bodily growth. And if you look at this graph here, way over on the far left, you can see ancient hominins here, Australopithecines, and as we come through to Homo sapiens, you can see that the adulthood period begins later in humans, whereas here it begins much earlier. And there's also the insertion of a childhood period of growth and then this adolescent period, which doesn't exist in other primates and doesn't exist in earlier species of human or hominins. So this looks at the same phenomenon, but from a different perspective. These are a chimpanzee and then the early human or hominin Lucy. This was a fossil that was discovered in the 1970s by Don Johansson, and when they were wanting to name the fossil at the excavation site, Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds was on the radio, so she was christened Lucy. And then the next one you can see is Homo sapiens. The thing to note is Lucy is actually of the similar stature and similar brain size to a chimpanzee. And when you look at Homo sapiens, here you can see that the body is much bigger and the brain is much bigger. So this extended period of growth is important for the development of a larger body and also a larger brain. And down the bottom, the same phenomenon is illustrated with all of the skulls that we've discovered, or a number of the skulls that we've discovered in human evolution. And here you can see there's small brain species, and as we come towards the present, you get these big, large brain species, which is obviously involved in our more complex forms of cognition. Looking at this idea of an extended period of development, I just want to look at the default mode network, because this is very important for the uniqueness of human cognition and why psychedelics actually alter human neural architecture so profoundly. The default mode network is active at rest. So when you're not doing anything, you're just daydreaming and thinking about things when you're not, you know, fixing your car or making a spear or whatever. It's kind of works in conjunction with working memory. It's important with social cognition, and particularly important with theory of mind, and humans have this unique capacity to think about the thoughts that other people have. And we can also think about the thoughts that other people have about other people, including ourselves. So it kind of makes, it creates this kind of collective brain, if you like, which is very important for collaborative planning, for hunting or whatever, making computers, this kind of collective brain that we exist in. It's important for mental time travel, which means kind of projecting yourself into the future and imagining future scenarios that don't exist in reality, but merely this kind of virtual reality within your own consciousness, this kind of theatre of the mind that humans have, which is very good for planning and therefore technological innovation. But it can also be problematic because it can overheat and cause lots of stress and tension. So the default mode network's involved in internal rumination. You can ruminate on the conditions of your existence, and that can, you know, that can be beneficial, or it can be a curse in some sense. The default mode network is also associated with the human ego complex, which is important when we get to psychedelics. What I want to emphasise is that the default mode network is not fully mature until adolescence. So the default mode network in infants and children is quite different to the default mode network that is in adolescents and adults. It doesn't reach full maturation and connectivity until adolescence. Interestingly, adolescence is a psychologically vulnerable period where risk for developing psychopathology, depression, psychosis, schizophrenia, suicide, self-harm, etc., that's a period during which risk increases. This period of development may go some way to explaining why initiation rites are so important, particularly in hunter-gatherer societies. Maybe a way of facilitating that transition from childhood through adolescence and into adulthood. And the default mode regions are overactive in psychopathology. Depression in the default mode network. Depression is the leading cause of ill health and disability worldwide, and more than 300 million people are currently living with depression, according to the World Health Organization. And there's Ophelia and Hamlet, just to show you how literature has dealt with these kind of issues. We know a fair bit about the ontogeny, or the development of the default mode network, how it develops within the individual lifespan. We know a lot less about the phylogeny of the default mode network. And ontogeny is individual development, phylogeny is the evolution of the species. And I'm really interested in the work of this guy, Stephen Jay Gould. He wrote this seminal book in the 1970s, Ontogeny and Phylogeny. And basically, he postulated that you can have the emergence of new species, not necessarily by new genetic material or mutations, but by slowing down or speeding up rates of development. So you can extend the period of development, or you can slow it down, and that will give rise to speciation events. Essentially, what I'm talking about is the extension of ontogeny to include extra periods of brain and bodily growth. If we want to understand the phylogeny of the default mode network or its evolution, there's a number of ways of going about it. And what we did is we collected a number of skulls, basically ancient human skulls from the fossil record. And across primate species, there are quite robust correlations between brain size and rates of maturation. So a very small brain primate like a tamarin or a marmoset, it will reach sexual maturity and other developmental milestones quite early. Whereas having a large brain primates, they reach sexual maturity much later. And that makes sense because to grow a bigger brain and a bigger body, you need more time. So we use those correlations to try and predict when extinct hominins or humans reached the age of sexual maturity and whether they had an adolescent period of growth and therefore whether they had a human or modern form of the default mode network. And you can see here when you go right over to 4 million years ago, these are kind of where Lucy would sit, these kind of small-brained and small-bodied creatures. They wouldn't have a modern form of the default mode network because there's not developmental space for one to develop. As we move to the present, coming here, you can see that the age of first birth or sexual maturity and when you move into adulthood actually increases. And then we get to 18 years of age, which in humans is the cross-cultural norm for age of first birth for females. So when we get here about 500,000 years ago, I'm suggesting here we would have an adolescent period of growth and therefore an incipient form of the default mode network. What's interesting to note is that 500,000 years ago or 500,000 years ago, we see the emergence of more complex forms of technology and weaponry in the archaeological record. This is like a spear. This is composite weaponry. To make this, you have to go out and get a stick. You have to get some stones and nap them to make the point. And then you need to get animal tendons to put the point onto the spear. So that requires quite heavy cognitive load, and it requires a lot of mental time travel, projecting yourself into the future and what you're going to do to make that artifact. More recently, this is from some of the caves in Europe, depictions of shamanism, and this sort of, we find this much more recently. So I just want to look at the work of Robin Carhart-Harris to kind of draw these various bits of information together. Now, Robin's done some trials with psilocybin, and he's been able to get very good results treating people with resistant treatment depression. They're preliminary studies, but they show that high-dose psilocybin therapy can actually be very, very beneficial.
Now I want to look at what happens in the brain when people are given psychedelics. And here are two images of the brain taken by the team at Imperial College. On the left, that's the normal brain, and on the right is the brain under psychedelics. On the right, you can see that there's increased connectivity between different brain regions when subjects are given psychedelics, which means that brain regions that are usually segregated from one another start communicating with one another. And there's increased communication or connectivity between the visual cortex, that's the posterior region of the brain, and other cortical regions of the brain. And that may explain the quite rich visual imagery that people experience on psychedelics.
This looks at the same phenomenon, but from a different point of view. If you look at the circle on your left, that's the normal brain, and all of the circles around the circle, all of the smaller circles, they're different brain regions, and the lines connecting them are basically the degree to which different brain regions talk with one another or communicate with one another. The brain on the right is the brain on psychedelics, or the picture on the right, sorry. And you can see all of these different brain regions that are usually segregated from one another, or dissociated if you like, they begin communicating, and you get a massive increase in global connectivity. This increase in global connectivity correlates with reports of ego dissolution on the part of the participants. And just to bring us back to what Nietzsche said, he mentioned the forgetting of the self. So this may be the kind of neurobiological substrate of why people have a sense of forgetting of the self during rituals. In the psychedelic brain, there's increased cognitive fluidity, more imaginative thinking, and we're suggesting that it's possibly a phylogenetic and or ontogenetic regression, which means if the default mode network matures during adolescence and when you take it, its connectivity is altered, you may regress to an early stage of ontogeny or your own personal life, which is why traumatic memories that you've not thought about for a long time and that have been buried in the unconscious may come to the surface, or you may have quite beautiful or joyous experiences of the kind that we associate with childlike forms of cognition. Human ontogeny is characterized by an adolescent period of growth. The default mode network is not fully mature until adolescence, and psychedelics desegregate the brain. This results in altered connectivity between cortical and subcortical brain regions. And it's interesting to note that this may be a parallel to what depth psychologists talk about when they're looking at the integration between the ego complex and the unconscious layers of the psyche, the kind of thing that Jung was interested in. Rituals may have been a very ancient technology whereby to achieve this state of integration between different brain regions, it may result in kind of the emancipation of more archaic modes of consciousness. So we've said that the default mode network possibly emerged within the last 500,000 years. When you take it, you may be regressing back to some of those early hominin species and the kind of consciousness they had, so a kind of archaic eruption, I suppose, of earlier stages of human evolution. Looking at this from a neurobiological point of view and more trials that will happen as we move into the future may address the global disease burden, which seems to be quite profound. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Gary.
Would it be possible to theorise that early hominids had more of a rich visual experience of living than us now?
That's a possibility. There's a guy called Ralph Holloway, and he's done work on what they call the lunate sulcus, which is where the visual cortex separates off from the rest of the cortex. And he thinks that's kind of changed throughout human evolution, which means there's been a decrease in visual forms of cognition and an increase in more frontal executive functions. So that's a possibility. And there's interesting work, like you read people like Temple Grandin, and she talks about thinking in visual imagery, and she thinks that people like her with autism are kind of a evolutionary kind of stage in between modern humans that are quite frontal and earlier humans. So it's a possibility.
Do you subscribe to the interpretation that as hominids and our species became so top-heavy with intelligence, big brains, and the capacity to have such greater levels of expression, the kinds of illnesses such as schizophrenia, depression, are they the price that we as a species have to pay, that at one end of the spectrum, so many of the people who really have heightened states of particularly expression, artistic people, brilliant people, are paying the price by often being the very people who also seem to suffer these conditions. Do you see that correlation?
I know there's research being done on that, and that it's, you know, you can have the evolution of a capacity which is adaptive in a certain context, and then it becomes maladaptive, or it has maladaptive byproducts. And I think our advanced intelligence is like that. There are blessings and there are curses. And we kind of are blessed and cursed, I think, because of this more complex trajectory of brain evolution.
I've seen evidence recently they've shown chimpanzees using spears to hunt. Has anyone ever looked at these particular chimpanzees?
There's very, very interesting work being done in cognitive archaeology where they look at which regions are involved in very, very simple tools. For example, when you merely have to knock off one tool, one piece of rock, and make a tool, okay, and that's quite simple. And they're the Olduvan tools that Australopithecines have been known to use. And that doesn't require the default mode network, and actually can use mirror neurons and imitative learning based on bodily imitation. So very primitive forms of tool making don't require those more advanced cognitive capacities. And that's why we're finding quite complex tools in these very, you know, 2 to 3 million years ago, but they're not the forms of composite weaponry where you have to go out and get a number of pieces and assemble them. To be able to make those forms of complex weaponry, you can't figure it out in your individual life. You have to have intergenerational knowledge transfer, so you have to teach young kids how to do it, which requires theory of mind, kind of forms of apprenticeship and things like that. So you need a different social structure, and the default mode network is implicated in these kinds of forms of learning and teaching and things like that. So, but I think we underestimate what very ancient humans could do without the default mode network, using just their bodies and copying one another, living in cohesive groups. Interestingly, chimpanzees were shown to do tasks, working memory tasks, that are equivalent or better than humans. But in terms of social cognition, if you drop something on the ground and a child walks up, that child will pick it up and give it to you. You do that with chimpanzees, they're just not interested in cooperating.
We used to think that there was a linear progression in the increasing brain size and the capacity of people. Now we have increasing evidence that a greater diversity of hominins or hominids, whatever word you want to use, to show that there are counterintuitive expectations where we find hominids with much smaller brains, but we have increasing evidence that they had things like the capacity to bury their dead, to have hunting rituals and other community activities that require considerable communication. They probably therefore also had language. We also find that Neanderthals have musical instruments. And so we're finding that there is now this counterintuitive discovery that brain size is no longer as clearly related to these different cognitive and communal abilities. And so I'm just wondering if this creates problems in the interpretation that you have of the ontogeny and the phylogeny.
There's an article called cortico-centric myopia, which means that we have, as Westerners, assumed that intelligence is the important factor and brain size. What I'm looking at is not brain size per se, I'm looking at the length of ontogeny which yields a bigger brain. And it's that period of that lengthened ontogeny where you have periods of socialization that are important. And the other important factor is if you have neurochemical changes, and I think changes in the serotonergic system very early in hominin evolution, and oxytocin and these kind of pro-social neurochemicals, if you have neural reorganization, you can get quite profound changes in social behavior in the absence of increases in brain size. So I think that these very early small-brained hominins were actually completely different to chimpanzees, and there's evidence of reduction in canine size, which suggests lack of social aggression and those kinds of things. So I think you're absolutely correct, and I think there's been a Western bias associating brain size with intelligence and therefore seeing a bigger brain and thinking they're superior to more ancient species. I think those ancient species would have had very complex forms of cognition, possibly more embodied forms of cognition, and less cortical, but nevertheless, you see tools in Indonesia at 1 million years ago, and that's Homo erectus, you know. So how did Homo erectus get from Africa all the way to Indonesia 1 million years ago? And this is, you know, way before Homo sapiens. So I completely agree with you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gary Clark. Round of applause, please.
Thank you.